Higginbotham then and even today is a family. Now, obviously, the issue is when you're 465 employees, that's a big family for most of us. And so, but what makes Higginbotham Higginbotham is the people, and it's all about the culture. I was thinking through, how do I get it to where everybody feels they have a seat at the table? So there doesn't seem to be the separation between management and everybody else. The idea is this group of managing directors, which is now about 40 strong, we want to get together, share best practices, meet one another, realize that, hey, that person in Houston's a great partner. I need to do business with them. They've got this specialty, et cetera. And maybe the collective we can deploy best practices amongst these 16 offices. So
it's a fun opportunity for me to meet our partners.
All the new partners.
Y'all, you know, if you've gone through an acquisition, you've met a lot of those folks, but it's a great opportunity for us to get to meet each other and do deals together.
That's right.
And you as managing directors, we ought to change your title, in my opinion, instead of managing directors, to sales leaders. Because you ought to be leading sales. Everything you do, all day long, you and all the people around you, you ought to be influencing them to lead and drive sales. And as a general rule, because there's a lot of research on it, those who set clear goals about the future have a much greater chance of reaching them than those who don't.
A lot of companies just kind of evolve and they just, you know, and they'll end up being great, great companies. But I think the companies that are strategic in their focus, strategic in their brand, strategic in what they want to be, those are the companies that really end up being phenomenal. And I just feel in my heart of hearts that we're poised as an organization to accomplish that. And so tomorrow, I want you to just think through every time we're talking about any of the multiple topics that we're going to bring up, you know, what can you control as a managing director and what can you provide influence over as a managing director? How are we going to provide focus? You know, as you're going to see tomorrow, and Tony's got this presentation, it will just blow your mind how fast our world is moving around us.
You know, a lot of us grew up thinking life did this, and I propose life's doing this now. What do you think? What through your mind? Jay, what went through your mind when you saw that?
What my six-year-old life would be like when she's my age.
Okay.
Granddaughter.
So how about this? Let's take a few minutes and have some discussion on this. What are some of the positives and what are some of the pressures? So team up with just someone around you real quick, if you would, in groups of two or three, please. What are the positives? What are the pressures today? What's the real thing? What are we dealing with? What's the real deal? Thank you for the involvement. Let's talk about what you discussed. Who had a good point come across, either on the positive side or the pressure side, that you might share with the whole group?
I think they're the pretty obvious things, and everything seemed to be in point and counterpoint. Like, the biggest pressure is the overflow of information that makes it harder to focus.
The positive is you've really got the ability now to attract partners unlike we've ever seen before. The negative of that is at the core, it's all about the culture. And so as you're getting bigger, how do you preserve that core, that culture, which is what originally attracted people to come to you in the first place? So in one sense, it's a great positive. On another sense, it creates tremendous pressure to preserve what we're really all about. At the end of the day, when clients are buying insurance from us, what are they trying to do? They're trying to control their cost of risk, right? That applies if you're a P&C person. That applies if you're a benefit person. It really doesn't matter. It's the cost of risk. And what do we do as a firm? We bring forward not just a product, but we try to get at the best cost. We want to have the best coverage, provide the best cash flow for our client. But we build a plethora of value-added services that do what? They help control that cost of risk, be it leveraging the compass plan to reduce that cost of risk, therefore long-term bringing down the cost of premium. We leverage risk management, loss prevention. We go in and implement a driver safety program for what? Bring down that cost of risk. We're going to walk into a client and we're going to go in together and we're going to say, here's what we're here to do. We're here to help you reduce your cost of risk. We're going to bring forward all of our solutions that will help not only bring that cost of risk down immediately, but more importantly, continue to bring that cost of risk down long term. And here is the way that we will bill for that service. And we're going to charge an amount up front, and we're going to lay out a service timeline, which will be very granular in laying out when things need to be done, how they need to be done, okay? And then we're going to hold a piece out as a retainer in the event that we don't do what we say we're going to do. Then that is money that you won't pay us. But if we do what we say we're going to do, then you owe us that as an essence of performance bonus, okay? And again, I just want to challenge each of you to think about this. But I'd love to see us set up a team by office. You go out and you literally deliver a macro solution for a client. In essence, our single source model. You said, you know, we know what all that will entail. And then you charge a fee with a performance component based on that deliverable. Okay? So, there's my challenge to each of you.